So great. Thanks for coming to the talk. So we will look after something called APM today. There are many aspects of this talk, so I'm particularly concentrating on getting started. So there are deep internals, like how do you configure. I have also attached a lab to it because we have very less time and we'll not be able to cover everything, but I'll give you those links so that you can go and do it by yourself step by step. So that being said, I'm Aravind and I work at Elastic as a developer advocate. I run the open source communities and developer relations for India and ASEAN. So basically speak at meetups, conferences, and interact with developers. I'm a developer myself, and I write code, and like I contribute to the Java agent, like in the APM space. So I'm a Java developer, but I also like Python because I use Python for doing TensorFlow and some sort of a machine learning related work. So that being said, what's up today? We have we have like a bunch of topics that we will discuss about the stack and like what is APM, why you need APM, what are the various concepts that are into this in this ecosystem. Then we'll also discuss about what it can't do and if possible, definitely a demo. So again, the thing that we are looking at here is the Elastic stack. So how many of you are know Elasticsearch or Elastic stack as such? Cool, quite a few people, good. So so basically, a lot many people might understand or know Elasticsearch as ELK, right? Elasticsearch Logstash Kibana. In that story, there are a bunch of other tools that have or projects that have been added over a period of time. So for example, Beats is a library which ships out data, which is like an agent and ships out data, installs on your server, ships out data from your source to the destination, works like a push model rather than like Logstash pull model, where you have it connect to API and like processes the data, etc. Logstash still has a lot more use cases. You know, Elasticsearch is a distributed REST-based storage engine, that's for sure. Then you also have Kibana, which is a visualizer into the Elasticsearch, which helps you to visualize stuff. It's like your window into Elasticsearch. So this is called as Elastic Stack. There are a bunch of people who developed multiple solutions on top of Elastic Stack or Elasticsearch itself, be it searching or like site search, app search, or be it logging, metrics. APM is one new edge to this, angle to this thing, or uptimes, sim. So there are many, many areas. So we call it as solutions because there are some problems and you kind of like use a stack to kind of mold it in a way that you solve your problem. So today we are specifically looking at APM. We are not concentrating on all the 360 degree picture. So there is something called observability, which is a standard that many of these open source orgs are like going to follow. So for example, CNCF, the Cloud Native Computing Foundation, has this observability as one of the thing that they say, and which APM plays a major role. Like you have logs, you have metrics. You collect logs, you collect metrics, you have application trace. So that means like, I'll show you a diagram end of the day, how it helps, right? How it is the pillar of this entire thing. So that being said, I'm also a Kubernetes fan. So I'm part of Kubernetes contributor experience. If any of you are interested in contributing to Kubernetes, let me know. So like I can help you with that as well, because I lead the SIG, I'm part of the SIG contribute experience. So great. What is APM, right? Sounds really cool. You can read all this, the cool text from Wikipedia, but you might feel like, okay, this has been done by all the speakers and I'm bored out of like text. I want to learn something interactive. So I'm the kind of guy like who don't read text. I can't read more text. I want to be like more thing. So let us take a use case and see how we can explain APM. So on a cool, Saturday morning or probably like Friday night, you do the deployment and like you enjoy and you kind of like everything is working and you are done with deployment, everything shows green or everything is working as of now, and then you enjoy with your colleague or like you start planning a movie with your girlfriend or something, right? So then suddenly you start seeing this, right? you start seeing a 500 or 503 or probably a 404, suddenly errors start coming up, and you would have that sort of a feeling like, okay, things are not well, and you get calls from your manager or someone who is responsible for that release. Then while you come up, you start fighting fire, right? You things are not controlled, and you open all of the tools, techniques, knowledge, you open everything. What you might be using your git diff command to see what changes have gone through. Did I check in anything that is not really, really tested? So all of this thing works. And once you try to fix one of these, and then you see this happens, right? So until then it is opening, it is not opening. So, and then you open all of these like tools to kind of do everything. So as a developer, I've been in this situation for several Saturdays. I used to work for a very popular financial company in the world. And we have successfully sometime shipped really a bad change, and it caused real loss to the customer. So I realized that how valuable is code, how valuable role as we play as a developer in sometimes. So at that point of time, I feel that after the Saturday, I feel like, okay, debugging is done. End of the day, I only debugged for a small change, and I put up a fix and everything. Maybe it's a semicolon or a comma sometime in a data, or sometimes it's probably indexing. Especially in Python kind of things, it probably you didn't indent the code properly, right? So there are many, many situations like that. So APM comes into rescue in such sort of use cases. I don't say it is like the one point solution to do everything, but it helps you in many ways. For example, for doing some sort of like, you know, next level to your logging and metrics, and helps you to understand what's happening. So traditionally, when you see exception, you might look at the build logs, or probably you might look at the application server logs to find out what's happening in the production. But APM is more of into the app. So it finds out and it tells you that where the error really occurring or what request is causing this problem. So again, talking about the same thing, like this is what I just explained. So you have a client and a server, and then you have, you could see that the same sort of a request sent by another client on another browser, another environment, another time or another region, whatsoever it might be. We are measuring, in some cases, we are measuring the time taken. What is the response time that is being given? So it monitors and manages your performance as well. So it helps you to find out your performance bottlenecks in your app. So APM, like, okay, a lot of text, like I'll explain you, APM does a lot of these things. You can take a glance, finding out your HTTP requests, lower operations, database queries, like what query is taking more time on your DB? Like if you are using something like MongoDB or MySQL, and you have ran a query and it is taking a bit of time. So how do you find out? So there is something called distributed tracing, through which you can visually tell where the span is taking more time, where it is dragging the request for a longer time, right? In traditional world, I don't know how many of you are working on microservice-based architecture. How many of you are microservice or developed microservices? So if you are not a microservice, you are not working in a microservice-based app, it's fine, probably. Monoliths are better, can be debugged better. But if you are into microservices, then it might get really, really difficult. And APM helps you a lot with distributed tracing. So yeah, there are many things that you can find out. You can find out 404s, 500s that are occurring in time. You can do all of that as well. So APM is an open source solution under Apache 2.0 license. So there are many, I do agree that there are quite a few projects in this space which does one or the other. There's a project from Google, which open sensors, which does a piece of it. There's Jagger, which does tracing. There are few other tools which are also really popular. We are compatible with all sorts of data from that side of projects as well. So we are compatible with Open Tracing API and all of this. So we are compatible, as well as we are a major open source project, which we see the tractions really built up. A lot many people in the community already use this quite a few times. So again, what are the supported languages? Python being the definitely a first hand client. So because we have Python support from the first few months, because we started with Node, then we moved to Python, and we started supporting Django and Flask. based networks, based frameworks. Then we also looked at Falcon kind of a framework as well. We are trying to do more, but it also depends on you. So you need to tell us what you need to just raise the issue. It's just an open source project. You can contribute, you can drive the project as well. So we need more people, the product managers, engineers, everyone is interested to take contributions. So I have spoken about the same talk in all the PyCon. So we have seen a lot of traction. So please let us know. I'll also share you a survey link at the end through which you can fill and see what you want to see in APM. So yeah, there are multiple of these frameworks. So where does APM fit in? Now I've been talking about stack and APM solutions, that is and all, but how are these modules fit in? So if you see, you know, traditionally you build Elasticsearch cluster for logging or whatsoever it is, then you have Kibana to visualize. You might have Logstash to do some or the other. Today with Beats, you can directly ship everything to Elasticsearch. You don't need Logstash in between, but you have all of this architecture. So APM is another, just another index in your Elasticsearch. APM is not something like really crazily different. So what APM server, which is sitting in between, does is like it takes all the agents. There are a bunch of application servers that you run your apps, right? Be it in containers, be it in VMs, wherever it is. So it takes all the data that is being emitted from your app, and then it creates a document for each with traces. It gives a trace ID, and it creates a document, and it will try to put it in a Elasticsearch in a document basis. So, and it does all of this. Kibana does all of this visualization, etc. So APM, all the tools, everything is OSS. So you don't need to worry about anything about specifically. So the app which is there is also free. So so you could go and like use that as well. So you could track clear application metrics, be it like response times, unhandled errors or exceptions. So I don't say everything is being captured with respect to exceptions and errors, but I have seen quite a few exceptions being captured in the Django. Whenever, suppose if you do a number format exception kind of area, so it simply captures that sort of a very easy application. I mean, very key, and it also points out to the code. So that drills down your issue. Okay, I think there's a repetition. Okay, great. So there is a APM terminology that I would like you to walk through. Yeah, we have time. So which helps you to like understand much detail about the open source project, than rather than like kind of literally like talking about the demo, etc. So whenever you put this APM agent, so agents are libraries. These are not clients or installers. These are libraries. For Python, it is a package. For Java, it's a jar. Or for some other language, for Go, it's a module. Or different languages, different sort of libraries, right? Extra libraries. So you install this actually, and you put it, or you can also put it as a download that and put it in your a build script or like the wherever the environment it is. And with each framework has its own way to load the dependencies. Like Django and Flask has its own way to load the dependencies. So you need to put that in that, and we have given clear the configurations and stuff to do all of this. So the basic difference here is like there are some jargons that probably might use, so that's why I want to cover. So whenever you put this and start the app, start streaming the data, then you have this service. So service is like with respect to an language. So if you have a microservice architecture, so you have Python service, which is Python based container set, which is running Python based app module, etc. Then you have Java based APIs, or you have front end, which is in React, or you have a Node.js based backend, which is taking all the front end requests. So all of this is like different thing, right? So the service is like you will have one single link, which is the service, and you just need to click on that. And then you will see several transactions. Like transaction is like when you start a request and somebody says like elastic.co or Python, PyCon.sg. So it starts a transaction to get to fetch the database and get all the data and shows to you as an HTML, right? When it leaves server, the transaction ends because the browser has to display it. So that is one transaction. Under each transaction, there might be many requests. So what we do is like every single event, every method call, every database query is called a span. So I'll show you how the span also looks at. There is a diagram that I could show you. Spans are like each request is considered as a span. So think of having this everything on a timeline basis. You started at 12 o'clock, you started requesting server, the server gets a request, then like 12:15, then it should not take so much time. So if you say 12:15, then it reaches database, 12:16, it database responds. So when you hand over to database, like the request literally went to the database, nothing is your hand and you're waiting for database to respond, right? So all such things are like, there are multiple spans, multiple stakeholders in the entire system, which is being handled. So errors, obviously, self-explanatory. So this is what I'm talking about, which gives you a clear picture. So you have a transaction, you have spans. So think of each span as different service or a module. So you can have Python, different Python services, like one Python service is doing one, and you can name this, even in the same language, traditionally it is like, how people do is like each language is for a specific purpose, but they don't keep multiple services in the same language. Someone like some large companies might have specific use case to do that, but you can think of it either ways, like one is a database call, one is something like business logic processor, etc., etc. So this is what I'm trying to explain you from the terminology point of view. And then I was telling like distributed tracing, then you have another concept on top of the same structure that we have told. Then you have service A and a service B, and the service A is kind of communicating to the service B. Then you also want to see how it is faring well. I mean, like whether it has delays, whether there is a issue between the data being sent. So several times when you test, when you have a microservice architecture, suppose you are running an e-commerce app, there is a search service in the app, there's a basically a web app team, and then on you have a search service, cart service, payment service, like order service or recommendation service. You have multiple services, right? Each service is a team and they need responses. They need, web team needs to pass on the request to search, search team might need to pass on to the recommendation, so you have links between them. So you might test it well as a start, but how do you like validate from the production? Like it might really get difficult and not obvious. Like it might not be really obvious that you test all the scenarios, right? How do you validate and find out all of the errors? So that way distributed tracing helps in that area. It helps you to like trace the network calls, helps you find that context. The request and response frame will be given to you so that you will see what the user has entered. So that can also be done. So yeah, in the conceptual manner, so this is what again I'm trying to explain. So you have fence 1, fence 2, fence 3, the user is trying to jump over all of that. So in some cases it's like one or two transactions which try to jump over, but it couldn't, it gets stuck and like it falls down, right? So you might want to find that transaction or that particular situation where the issue is being created. So that is where your APM comes into picture and helps you to find out that particular specific spike or area. So yeah, there are from the Python instrumentation point of view, we support these two frameworks. So there are many in roadmap, and like there are quite a few frameworks or like quite a few improvements that we have done. So you could also do custom instrumentation. Like you can do you want to only monitor a specific method which is doing some processing. Then you could do like a specific capture span kind of annotation kind of based on thing. If you think that nothing works, I have my company has my own framework, I have written something specific, you could generally go and like use the public API. So through public API, you can build your own support for your own thing. You just need to follow the standard. What we use in the APM client is not so different. So let me show you the thing, if the internet is working. So yeah, great. I hope it works. So this is the APM repo, the GitHub one. So this is the APM repo. So you have all the APM agents code and everything. So APM server is written in Go and agents are in the respective language. So if I go to the Python agent, which I believe, no, it's not there. So if I go to the Python agent and I have docs and all of this, so there is a specific library that we use to do. So in each language, sometimes we need to do in Java, we might need to do some bytecode manipulation, something like we use a library called ByteBuddy. So similarly, in Python, we use a specific language where we have the person who wrote the library in the room today, like Graham has written that. So we are really glad open source helps open source. So in a way that we are really glad about that. So there are many such tools you can find out here. The code is open and you can kind of like write more details about it. So you could contribute. So we just need to like go and look at a contributing.md. So please look at like issues, and if there are something like good first issue, you would be able to like kind of do it. Let me show you if there are labels for that. So yeah, here, good first issue or help wanted. Okay, there are two closed already. So you could kind of like contribute to that. But if you want an example to implement in your own area, so you could simply go and like look at this project called Obbin's Python. So Obbin's Python is a coffee shop example. So the agent is implemented. So you have a Docker compose file. So if you don't want to compile and run, and you just want a container based thing, you know, we have written a Docker compose file, and like you can just simply run it. But also like you can download the code and start doing that. That can also be possible. Then this is one another thing. So let me show you how this service works when you kind of like implement it. So if you go to the Spring Boot or like the Spring framework, they have a microservice example called Pet Clinic. So we have used that itself and like tried to build a multi-stack microservice app. So where there are multiple, you know, languages, each language has a specific thing. So Python does search for us in that area. So you could also go and like look at this particular thing. I don't know why it shows. Okay. Great. So yeah, you have Python client for that, which does the search for us. So if you go and look at the transactions or the items found, so it shows the views that you have. For example, home, product, customer, top customers, and which page is used more, the transaction duration, request per minute. Now you could also, if you have a specific library like celery and like you want to do that particular tracking, you can do that. But let us go and look at one request. Which one do we take? Let us take home only. It has more data. It has 125 transactions. So this is live data. You could also go and look at it. Demo.elastic.co is a live site that we maintain, and you can go and look at the APM app and everything. So we are specifically looking at, so this is the transactions on the timeline, and it shows like how many transactions have happened at 400 millisecond, 500, 600 millisecond. There are some transactions which has taken more time, like 1200 milliseconds. Let us click on the 1200 millisecond one. And then you could see that transaction being updated, like it's still trying to get the data. Come on. Okay. Yeah. So you have two spans here, like, because we are looking at Python, only that particular module. We are not looking at the full microservice stack. If you look at the entire stack, I'll show you in a minute that as well. You will see how the handoff is happening between thing and like the entire timeline. So if I click on this one, it will show you where the issue is or where the span is done and like what are the stack trace, etc., labels, everything. I'll also try to show if there is any errors in this entire thing. Obbin's Python. Okay, good. There are one or two, three errors. Okay, there are new errors that I'm seeing. But anyway, I'm looking at a specific error that is not here. Okay, so there is suppose a specific error like assertion error, and you want to see if you are not getting a relevant result, then you could see the code. And like we are also having, we are looking at doing a specific open source project again called Code Search. So wherein you would be able to put up a fix or do things entirely from the code point of view whenever you see a issue. Like it's like an end-to-end developer stack. So we want to do that as well. So yeah, so this is one such thing. So I'll go back and try to look it from the Node.js area so that you will see maybe one or the other. Get unknown root. I believe there should be one or two transactions. Come on. So the internet, I'm running on my hotspot, so it takes some time to kind of look up. So there is a lab that we have done. So I'll share that link as well, so that you could do it. So this is a specific lab that we have done with Java agent. So I have seen the similar way. I have a lab for Python agent as well. So I'll give you the link so that in the slide, so that you can find a link and like you can check in that, and I'll put up that PDF as well so that you can go and do stuff. So yeah. So if you could see here, we have Node.js and like kind of like how it translates into each one thing. So some cases, if you have a database integrated and if it is taking how much amount of time it took in that particular transaction also is mentioned. So that is a win-win situation for several of them. So yeah, coming back to the topic, what you can't do with APM. So like we spoke about several of these, but it is also important that you need to understand that what is not possible, right? When you are doing a technology, sometimes somebody says like, you just need to know what are the don'ts, do's are self-explanatory. So you can't do this thing. Like you can't do infrastructure monitoring. You can't do log analytics. Like you can't send logs. You can't do detect security attacks from inside the app. But how we can help, obviously, like Elasticsearch is a very popular tool to do several of these things. So we, as I told you, like we are trying to build the observable stack, observable 360 degree infrastructure solution. So here you have Beats and Logstash for doing log. You have for doing server level monitoring, like CPU system, all of this. You can use again one or the other Beats. So Beats is a Golang based library. Then you have APM to do that. We also have a RUM agent, a real user monitoring agent, to put it in your single page apps or your which goes into the browser and like try to understand what's happening in the browser, because there are many client side technologies right now like React Native and Angular, which helps you to kind of do all of this so easily, right? So that is one other thing. So I have this particular link. So so this talk has been presented at multiple areas, like all the PyCon APAC, PyCon Thailand, PyCon Singapore now, and there are few other conferences. All the PyCons we have covered in the Southeast Asia. So please look into this. I'll put up, but if you don't find lab link, I'll put up that as well, the Dropbox link as well, so that you can go and download that lab and do it by yourself. So if you have more questions and if you have more things, please let me know and I'm happy to answer. I hope there is a bit of time.